It's got some weight to it, Tony.
Well, I say if it's heavy, it's good quality.
Whoop. It's all pine, it's heavy grade pine. 1860, 1870, it's certainly got a Gothic revival feel about it. Lovely columns at the side. It's a one-off made for somewhere particular, a town hall or, I mean, it could be a station clock. It was definitely for outside, because look at the state of it. It's just a lovely looking thing.
It's got a lot missing. I mean, luckily we've got all the roof, but we're missing a door.
Missing the door.
And it's missing a plinth, isn't it? It's missing some feet. Have you had a look inside?
You know, I've had this out. There's no maker's mark, but it's as rough as it comes.
Blimey.
The clockmaker might be able to help us. It's obviously been in a barn for 100 years, probably, or 50 years.
You do pick them. Do you know what? I think it'd look great with a little shingles roof on, wouldn't it? Little wooden tiles look amazing on there.
Absolutely with you on that one. Love it. Love it. This just keeps its integrity. I mean, this is this whole history of its life here.
A nice dome glass in it would be good, wouldn't it?
Gosh, something you that could really find something like off. That. Yeah. That would be amazing. If Alex can lock in the age and the distress and the 140, 50 years of its life and get that finished just so, I mean, what a timepiece. What a fantastic decorator's piece.
Value-wise?
I mean, $5,000?
Exciting project.
It is exciting.
Great find. Alex, well done.
Good luck. Take
good
your
to see
time,
you again.
Brother. See you soon.
This is by far the biggest clock I've ever worked on. It's enormous. There are a lot of tough elements on this job. It's going to take some work, but I think what we're left with at the end is going to be mighty impressive.
Alex's first job is to shore up the rickety clock by fitting a new plinth around the base.
Now, this is the piece of timber I think I'll make my plinth out of. Good, chunky, solid piece of mahogany. Now, I think we'll do something nice and decorative. If I do this properly, I'll be able to stand the clock up, it'll stop it rocking, and it means I can crack on with the rest of the restoration.
The mahogany is cut to size on the table saw. Then Alex needs to plan how he will joint the pieces together.
Now that I've cut my blocks to the right length, I need to put a 45 on. What that 45 will do, when it fits to the clock, I can stick a block onto it for some additional decoration. Now, I can see on the piece of wood that, given the whole scale of it, my blade can't reach all the way through. So all I'm going to use, hand saw to finish off that cut, use the 45 that the machinist set as my guide, and then we'll have a nice accurate angle.
If Alex has got his angle spot on, the pieces of timber should fit seamlessly together.
Now, this is the beginning of my plinth. And you can see now, when I put them together, and that's with a nice flat face here, I've cut blocks to size, and when they're put in place, basically, we've got a plinth that comes round and wraps around.
The blocks are glued in place, and once set, it's time to finish the plinth with a period stepped moulding, which will match the rest of the clock.
There you go. Now we've got our plinth, basically I'm going to run the router around it, give it a lovely detail. I just hope it looks right, because once it's gone round, it's taken that timber away. You can't stick it back on. Now, I've taken a mirror off the wall, leaving a very blank space, but it's all for the cause. I've got a lovely piece of convex mirror here. I'll use chemicals to strip off that mirror. I'll be left with a lovely piece of convex glass, which I can build that door around.
First, Alex strips the paint from the rear of the mirror. He then applies metal polish, removing the reflective surface to reveal the clear glass behind.
It's slowly making its way through. The problem is this glass is delicate and I don't want to break it. I am chuffed with that. Now, I need to build a frame for this, and making a round frame is quite difficult. But I've been so lucky, when I hold this up to my clock, it's a perfect fit. I'm going to cut this decoration off and use the back of this frame as the base for my new frame, then build a new piece on the front, fit the glass in, and we're off.
The mirror surround features a decorative plaster relief, which Alex removes.
It's just a matter of being patient, making my way around with a chisel, freehand, and just get it to the right shape. Of course, it needs a bit of tidying up afterwards, but that's to be expected.
Next, the clear piece of glass is set back into the frame using a hard setting filler.
What I'm trying to do here is build a sort of a bridge across to where the domed glass meets the same level as the frame.
Alex must be careful not to crack the delicate convex glass. Once the filler has gone off, Alex's final step is to create decorative paneling for the front of the door using veneers.
I'll use the clock as my template for the shape I need to cut with my craft knife. Start nice and light, and then as you feel the knife start to follow and get into that groove, you can increase the pressure without the risk of breaking it.
The veneer sections are carefully glued into place.
Now, the most important thing here, as I go around like this, is that I keep my circle shape. I don't want it to start looking like an egg shape.
And what started as a decorative mirror is beginning to take shape as a clock door.
It's round and it's complete. Bit of sanding and a bit of finishing on that, and that'll be ready to go on.
When he last visited Alex's workshop, Tony Gearing left him with a huge challenge in the form of a large station clock, which was in a terrible state. Today, he's back to collect it.
When I first saw it, it was like, wow, what is that? I mean, it's a giant's clock. It's just such a statement piece. So hopefully Alex has put this all back together and we'll find a giant who loves it. Alex.
Tony.
How are you, mate?
Good to see you again. You'll never guess what's under here. Should we have a look?
I'd love to see it. Yes, please. Let's come on. Oh, my word. What a fantastic job. It's got the wow factor. It is such a cranky, clunky old sort of Frankenstein grandfather clock.
Yeah, I agree. That's why when I've done the work on it, I've gone with that style. Everything oversized, everything a little bit...
chunky. Like... oh, wow, the finish is amazing.
The bulk of it's original, just clean and waxed.
Just looks super.
When it arrived, this once grand clock was in a sorry state. Its mechanism was broken and the wooden body was wobbly and tired. Alex has crafted a new plinth, a convex glass door, and topped it off with a tiled roof. Horologist Paul got the movement working again, and now it keeps time just as accurately as when it was first made.
Hang about, where did you get this?
At this moment of inspiration, looked up on my wall where I've got all these convex mirrors.
Love it!
The silver came off nicely. I used the original mirror frame.
Okay.
Re-veneered it to match. If you give this a...
oh, look at
that's
that.
That's just lovely, isn't it? It's been off to horologist Paul, and he's just cleaned the thing, got it all working, it's completely smooth.
You know, it's that lovely sound where you can just sort of sit back and relax in your armchair after Sunday dinner and kind of slowly nod off. With that.
Nice, lazy tick.
I mean, that's a great selling point.
It's lovely, isn't it?
The movement's working, tickety-top, tickety-top. And the statement I was hoping for, the kind of wow factor. He's pulled it off again. That boy can work the magic. He surely can.
I remember this being cheap, wasn't it?
£200, box of firewood. But because it's such a grand, stately thing, I thought, well, you know, £5,000? I mean, if you want a big grandfather clock, where are you going to find one? Mm. You'll look forever. God, another fine mess I got you into that you've got yourself out of again. Well done, brother. I can't get it in a van at the minute.
No.
I'll pop round in the morning. You about in the morning?
I'll get it wrapped up for you.
Oh, brilliant. Alex, breathtaking. You just, I don't know, every time you blow me away. Thanks, man.
Cheers,
see you in the
morning. Tony.
Have a good
take
night.
Take care. Whenever you're doing anything creative, everybody has their doubts. You always wonder whether it's good enough, whether the look is there, whether it's just too unique. But when you've got someone with Tony's caliber, who's got an amazing eye for detail, who understands his furniture like nobody else, that's just great praise.